ilaha illallah Muhammadun Rasulullah Muhammadun Rasulullah Arju ridaka ya Allah Antal rahimu ya Allah Habni ataka ya Allah Antal karimu Minkal ataa ya Allah Antal azimu ya فيك الرجاء يا الله أنت الحليم.
We shall now have the lecture by Sheikh Saeed Rageah talking on the topic of status of women in Islam. As we all know world over, women have always been a subject of discussion relating to events of oppression and lack of true status that as mothers, as sisters, and as daughters are deserving of. And it is a great means of achieving what we are here to set out for. That is to establish a peaceful society and a peaceful home comprising of both men and women. Working towards this cause of elevating the status of women, in today's conference here at the Dubai International Peace Convention, we take this opportunity to acknowledge, to understand the true perspective of the status of women, and particularly with regards to the status of women in Islam. Our speaker, Sheikh Saeed Rageah, was born in Somalia, raised in Saudi Arabia, and in the late 80s found his way to North America. He holds a bachelor's in Islamic studies, as well as a master's in Sharia from the Institute of Islamic and Arabic Sciences, Fairfax, Virginia. Over the years, he has held several posts, including founder of Masjid al-Huda in Montreal, Masjid Aya in Maryland, Muslim Youth Magazine, and Aqsa Association. After serving as an imam in Maryland, Calgary, Sheikh Rageah moved to Toronto with his family, where he is now discharging his various duties at the masjid, and he travels the globe extensively as a lecturer. He has been associated with several establishments promoting the true message of Islam in the context of the teachings of the Quran and the authentic ahadith, and of many of his associations. He is the founder of Oasis magazine, founder IQ, which is the Quranic Institute, with branches now in the United States of America and in Canada. He's also associated with the NBA, the Muslim Basketball Association, true to the gift that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given him and taking advantage of that. MashaAllah, he's 6 feet and more, perhaps. He's the co-founder and the chairman of the Journey of Faith Conference, which is held annually in Eastern Canada. He's also the co-founder of Power of One annual conference, which is held in Western Canada, founder of Leadership Camp for You Muslim Youth, and this is the fourth year in Western Canada and second in Eastern Canada. He's also the director for Ummah magazine, counselor at the University of Calgary, Muslim chaplain of University of Calgary and South Alberta, Southern Alberta Institute of Technology, founder of MSL of Calgary, Youth Hotline, founder of Orphans Matter, founder of Muslim Students Loan Foundation, founder of Sakina Foundation. Sheikh Saeed Rageah has studied under several renowned scholars of our times, including Sheikh Ibn Uthaymeen and Dr. Sheikh Abdulaziz Fawzan. Sheikh Saeed Rageah also participated in many conferences around the world, such as Peace Conference in India, the Dubai International Peace Convention, and this is his third time here for the Dubai International Peace Convention. The GPU, the Global Peace and Unity Conference, held in UK, and the Journey of Faith in Canada. Sheikh Saeed Rageah partook in many media corporations around the world, including Peace TV, 680 News, ABC News, BBC, CBC News, CBS News, CNN, City News, Global News, Los Angeles Times, Fox News Channel, NBC News, The New York Times, Omni News, National Post, and the list goes on. I'd like to take this opportunity to stop and really call Sheikh Saeed Rageah for his next talk on the topic, Status of Women in Islam.
إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهدي الله فهو المهتد ومن يضلل فلن تجد له وليا مرشدا وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما أما بعد إخوتي في الله اعلموا أن خير الكلام كلام الله وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار ثم أما بعد. The title that I was giving to speak about was the status of women in Islam. And I want to give you a glimpse. I want to take you with me to a journey. And I want you to abandon this world. Forget that you are in Dubai at this moment. Allow me to talk to your heart. Open your mind and listen to the words of Allah and to the words of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And let us take this journey together to show you the status of women before Islam, after Islam, and then today, and how women are used, abused, misused. I want to start my talk with a beautiful story. This is story, ikhwati fillah. It begins with a group of people sitting in a casual sitting. In this group of people, there's a man that always and every single event is present. He's never absent. He's never missed. Yet he does not say anything. He does not smile. And he does not participate. So one of the people who was sitting, he said to this man, "Ay fulan, ma bika, O fulan, what is wrong with you? Ma laka la tabtasim wa la tadhhak? How come you don't smile? How come you don't laugh? How come you don't enjoy the days that we talk about, the days of Jahiliyyah? We find and we see Umar bin Khattab laughing. But how come you don't talk? You don't smile and you don't laugh?" قال أي أخي, oh my brother, let me tell you my story and then you tell me if I have the right to smile. He said, before Islam, every time that my wife gives birth to a baby girl, I leave her alone at the time of delivery and I come back when she delivers her child. And I say to the zawja or to the wife, "What have you delivered?" And if she says a boy, then this is a joy of my life. I earn the respect of my community. I earn the respect of my people. But if she says, I have delivered a baby girl, I will say to her, Jahiziha, get her ready. And I will take that little girl and I will rip that child from the hands of her mother. And the mother is crying, saying, Ay Zawji, oh my husband, she is nothing but an innocent child. Leave her alone, let her live. But I have to choose between living with dishonor and disrespect and disgracement, or bury her alive. I take that little girl, I dig a grave in the middle of the desert, and I bury her alive. And then the next time comes, I'll do the same thing to every born baby girl. In one of those incidents, I left the house as usual. My wife is in labor. And I came back and I said, what did you deliver? A boy fa'atazzu bih? Did you deliver a boy so I can be proud of? Or did you deliver a girl, a source of disgracement and disrespect? She said, I deliver a girl, but she died. He said, that is better for me. And he walked away. He said, she said, 4 years later, my relatives came back. They brought their children. Among those children is this little beautiful, cute little girl. She has the dark, black, curly hair. She has wide, big eyes with long eyelashes. She has beautiful eyebrows as though someone drew those eyebrows. And she's so friendly. She's so playful. She's running around, and I thought my husband would be so mad when he sees that little girl. But when he saw her, and she's running left and right, his face changed, lit up, and he started bringing this little girl closer and closer and closer to himself. And every night he comes home and he said, Atadrina ma fa'alat? Do you know what that little girl did? And he would quote little incidents that she did. And he's so happy about this little girl. And the mother started growing confidence in herself. And then one of those nights, she said to her husband, do you like that little girl? He said, like? I love her. She's so cute. قالت أي زوجي, oh my husband, that little girl is the girl that I gave birth to her 4 years ago, that I told you that she died. His smile dropped. His face frowned. His eyebrows came close together. And his eyes turned red. And she was sitting next to him, and he pushed his hand away from her, and he said, in the sabah, when the sun rises, jahiziha, get her ready. Get her ready. And the mother started crying. And in the morning, he grabbed the baby's hand, and he walked away from the tent. And the mother, with tears on her eyes, but Allahu ya'lam, Allah knows, is not the tears that shedding tears, is the heart that tearing, that shedding blood. She reached out to the husband and she said, Iyaka, Iyaka, fa innaha hadiyya, be aware, indeed she is nothing but a gift from God. She's nothing but a gift from God. But the man had heart of stone. And he walked and he walked and he walked and he came to the middle of the desert and he placed that little girl right next to him and he started digging her grave. And that little girl, with passion and love and compassion, every time dirt lands on his bier, she would just get up, you know, innocently, because she's so innocent. And she would come and she would clean the bier of the man. And the man would say to her, sit down, iyaki anni, get away from me. And then when he dug deep enough, he grabbed that little girl by her legs. And he, while he was dropping, the little girl repeated the statement of her mother, iyaka, iyaka, fa innaha hadiyya, iyaka, be aware, she is nothing but a gift from God. And he let her go and she landed there, heard the little baby start crying, but the man still had heart of stone, and then he started burying her alive, and the sand came piling on that little girl until her voice is dying out. And he walked away. And the man, he turned to the man who asked him the question and he said, now you tell me if I have a right to smile. You tell me if I deserve to laugh. You tell me if I deserve to have mercy. That was the status of women before Islam. That's how Arabs used to deal with their own children. And that's how Allah painted the picture in the Quran. And he said, وَإِذَا الْمَوْءُودَةُ سُئِلَتْ بِأَيِّ ذَنْبٍ قُتِلَتْ. And when the little girl, when the little baby girl is buried alive for whatever sin that she have committed to deserve that. It was not only the Arab who used to be like that, brothers and sisters. In 586 after the birth of Isa, according to them, some of the Western countries were debating, should we consider women humans or demons? Henry VIII, he said it is forbidden for women to touch the Bible because they are impure. Imagine the messenger of Allah, or imagine al-Sahabi, or imagine Ahmad bin Hanbal, or Abu Hanifa saying women are not allowed to touch the Quran. It was 1886 when in Great Britain the women were allowed to have citizenship. But look at Islam. Islam did not say like that. Islam said no. Women in a lot of places, a lot of times, are better than men. And they are in many, many places. And read Surah Ali Imran, brothers and sisters, if you don't believe the speech of this speaker. When the wife of Ali Imran, when she got pregnant, and she said to Allah, oh Allah, whatever I'm carrying is a gift for you to serve Masjid al-Aqsa. And in her mind, she thought that by having a boy to serve the Masjid al-Aqsa is the best gift that you can give to Allah. And when she delivered Maryam, a little girl, قالت ربي إني وضعتها أنثى والله أعلم بما وضعت. She said, Ya Allah, I deliver a baby girl. وليس الذكر كالأنثى. Males are not like females. They're not equal. Why? Because in reality, the one that gives is strength, power, legacy, preserve the dignity of the ummah, is not the brothers, but the sisters. It's the sisters. Not the brothers, it is the sisters. Because without them, Az-Zubayr ibn Awam would not be what he was, radiyallahu anhu. Without them, Imam Ahmad bin Hanbal, rahimahullah, would not be what he was, Imam Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah. Without the mothers, Imam Shafi'i will not be the Imam of the Ummah. Without the mothers, Imam al-Bukhari would not leave a legacy for the Ummah. Imam Malik would not exist without the mother. Imam al-Awza'i would not be what he became without his mother. Imam Hassan al-Basri would not be what he was or what he became without the mother. It was never the father, it was always the mother. And this is where the Ummah today fell. This is where the Ummah fell today, to understand the status of women. Imam Ibn Taymiyyah had 6 female teachers. As a matter of fact, Taymiyyah was the name of his grandmother, wasn't the name of his father. Imam Ibn Hajj al-Asqalani, he had 9 scholars, female scholars. In the history of Islam, there was not one single lady that was ever reported being weak, fabricated, or a liar. But there are thousands of men who lied about the Messenger of Allah, about the Deen of Allah. The day that we confine our women to the kitchen, cooking, and changing diapers, that is the day that we went downward. The day that the Western society realized our true strength, and they went to them and sold to them the idea of corruption, and you must leave your household, you must leave the authority of the house and raising children, that is the day that we were defeated, not the day that we lost the khilaf. La wallah. Understand, my brothers and sisters, that your messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, kama fi sahih Muslim, qala man ala jariyatain, whoever takes care of 2 girls, in Sunan al-Tirmidhi wa sahahahu al-Albani, in another narration it says, 2 sisters, 2 daughters, whoever raised them well until they reach of the puberty, until they reach that age, he is my companion in Jannah. Did you ever read a hadith saying whoever raised 2 boys will be with the Messenger of Allah in Jannah? Never. Why? Because if our sisters, our mothers, our wives, and our daughters, if they fear Allah, and if we raise them well, then Islam is well and will be strong.
He created the universe. To him belong the heavens.